Good afternoon. Welcome to CEC Live Lectures. This is our series on computer science. As you are all aware, we have been discussing various topics related to computer science in this series. My name is Dr. Pavitra Bharadwaj and I work as an assistant professor in one of the constituent colleges of the University of Delhi. We have been discussing various topics in this series in CEC, and our basic aim and objective and focus of the lectures is to address the curriculum being taught at the undergraduate level in the various universities of India. But these are more comprehensive lectures and some of the topics are very general topics which may be of use to students at various level in their education, and those who are not pursuing computer science per se may also be interested in these lectures because of the day-to-day relevance of these lectures. So, in this series today we are going to continue our lecture series on spreadsheets. Last time we had discussed in the first lecture in this series, we had discussed about what are spreadsheets, the basics of spreadsheets applications, and we had tried to understand what are the advantages and what are the purposes of using spreadsheets and what has made spreadsheets such an important and inevitable software of all organizations, whether it is business or it is education, and therefore making it so relevant for the curriculum also to touch upon certain spreadsheet applications. So, primarily we were discussing the spreadsheet application, as we've seen that there are multiple commercial products which are based on the spreadsheet application, but here we will be basically taking the examples and the interface of Microsoft Excel as our software of choice, but more or less the functions of other spreadsheet applications, like if we talk about OpenOffice Calc or if we talk about any other spreadsheet application, they are also more or less the same, barring a few syntactical differences. So basically, if you know the functions and if you know the usage of one application, you can easily migrate from that application to any other spreadsheet application. So we'll just quickly go through. So we had seen that in Microsoft Excel, basically a spreadsheet is an integrated collection of rows and columns, and these are basically used for mathematical and financial data processing and data manipulation applications. So this is what an Excel spreadsheet looks like. We had seen this last time also. So you can see here that there are columns which are named as A, B, C, D, E, and there are cells numbered as 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. And wherever a column meets a row, there you find that there is a cell. So, this is basically a simple diagram which shows the different parts of this, and very importantly I would like to bring your attention to this part, which is actually known as the formula bar. So, whatever you type in any of the cells here is shown here, the formula is shown here. So, we will be doing what actually are formula and how you write formulae, but the point is that the data or the result shown in the cell, but the formula will always appear whenever you click on any of the cell. If the value in that cell is coming by the use of any formula, so you will see that formula here. Therefore, this is known as the formula bar, and these are of course the cells, and here this is known as the status bar because you see the present status of your cursor. So, in which cell exactly your cursor is can be seen here. So, this is known as the status bar. So, we had seen that the cells, they are addressed as A1 or A2 or so on. That is, cell A1 means that the A-th column and the first row, A2 means the A-th column and the second row, P10 will mean the P-th column and the 10th row. So, wherever the P column will meet the 10th row, the cell P10 will be formed, and this is where you will enter the data. So, basically data in Excel is entered in the cell. The basic unit of entering data in Excel is the cell. So, in the cell we will always enter the data. Now today we are going to start basically with formulas. So, what are formulae? Now, in Excel, we say that the power of Excel lies in the use of its functions and its number crunching strength, which is available by Excel. So, in Excel, basically, you can write a number of formulas. Now, formulas are actually equations which perform certain calculations on your spreadsheets. So, a formula must always begin with an equal to sign, and whenever you enter an equal to sign into a cell, you are basically telling Excel that you have to calculate this. So, if you put is equal to A1 into B10, so then what you will get after you strike the enter key, what you will get is the product of these values. So, you can write is equal to 2 into 3. So, this means you are trying to calculate the result of this calculation. So, that is known as a formula. So, basically Excel offers this kind of a calculation interface, and that makes it so popular as a calculation software. So, formulas are, now when you talk about formula, there is very common term which is used along with formula, that is called the functions. Now, what are functions? Functions are basically formulas which are defined by Excel already. So, they are predefined formulas in which you can put in your data. They ask you to supply the data, and you select, either you can type the data or you can select, and you press the enter key. So, basically these formula or these functions, they are predefined, and they will directly return the value once they are supplied with the correct data. So, the syntax and the way these functions are used is also specific for the package. And so, the functions that we will see as in the following parts of the lecture, we will see that functions are of various types. They have the Excel has a robust collection of functions in each category, like numeric or financial and so on and so forth. We will be going through all that. So, it has got a large collection of these functions, and using these functions, we actually build the formula. So, whenever you are using a function, you are actually building a formula, you are actually writing a formula. So, functions are used to write formulas. So, this is basically the relationship between a function and a formula. So, basically all functions, they have again the same format, because you want Excel to calculate something which the function is specifying. So, again it has the same format, that all functions, they have to be preceded by an equal to sign. Then you write the name of the function. As I already told you, these are predefined functions, so their names are also defined by Excel itself. So, you have is equal to, and then you write the name of the function. For example, a simple example has been given here. If you want to find out the average of say three numbers, so what do you write? You write is equal to average. Average is the predefined name in Excel, and then you write 2, 3, 4, 5, or you just supply the numbers. So, basically the data which you are supplying inside the parenthesis, it is known as the arguments of the function. So, you specify certain arguments, you give some parameters to the function, and the function acts. So, just by striking the enter key, you will get the average of the numbers 2, 3, 4 and 5, because you have specified that you want to calculate the value. If you do not put the equal to sign before the function, then the value will not be calculated. What you will see is the simple formula only. So, calculating for, if you want the result of a formula, you must always have an equal to sign before the name of the function or the name of the or the formula begins. So, basically in case of for example, when we are talking about calculation of the value, for example, we are saying the use of average function. So, you can supply the range of values in two different ways. Either you specify by separating them by comma. For example, if you want to calculate the average of the cells B1, B2 and B3. So, you can write B1, B2, B3. Or the other way is, if you have a large number of cells on which the function has to act, then you can specify it in the form of a range. So, you can simply type the cell starting cell reference, put a colon, and you can put the ending cell reference. So either you can do it using the keyboard, you can type in, or what you can do is that you write the name of the function and you just select the range on which the formula is to act, on which the function is to act, and that you can do the selection can be done through a mouse, and then you put the closing parenthesis. So in that case you don't even have to type, just simply by selecting the range by a mouse you can put in the parameters, or you can supply the function with its arguments, and then the function will work on it. So we have discussed about functions. We are starting our discussion on functions now. So you can see here, in case of an Excel sheet, what you are seeing in front of you, you can see you have in the toolbar, you can see there is a symbol called fx, and if you will click, fx stands for functions, and if you will click on that, you see a number of functions. And also when you click on functions, you also have an important link which I would like to mention here, that is called as reference. So reference basically is like a guidebook for all the functions. So it has got the complete description with examples of all the functions which are available in each of these categories. So I would like to recommend that whenever you have any question or whenever you have any doubt while using a function in Excel, kindly refer to the reference section in the function, and then you can get a very well given description about each of the functions that you are using. So when we are building a formula, this is an example worksheet that I would like to show you. So for example, here you want to calculate the marks of three subjects. So what you write here in the cell is, you write is equal to, and then you give the cell reference of the cells which are here. So you want to calculate the sum of these three cells. So you just supply, you just write the formula, and then either you can select these cells with a mouse, or you can simply type the cell reference using comma. If you can see here, this is showing you there is an equal to sign which is preceding here, and here what you see is also the function. Now when you will press the enter key, this cell will show you the value, the result of the calculation, but still here you will see the formula. So by clicking on the cell, you can see in the formula bar what formula was used to give, to calculate a certain value. So this kind of a feature is very important, because you get to know that which values are data values and which are computed values which you are getting by the use of a certain formula or a certain function that you have used in the cell. So then it becomes quite easy. In one cell when you write the data, or in one cell when you write the formula, if you have say 100 rows following that for which you want to do the calculation. For example, if you want to calculate the total marks of three subjects for 200 students, so then only in the first cell you need to type the formula, and for the other cells what you have to do is just copy and paste a cell or range of cells, that is, you know, easily you can fill up the worksheet with your data. So what you have to do is simply select the cell which you want the data to be copied, and you click on the copy or the standard toolbar, or just simply click on the cell, and on the right hand side bottom corner of the cell you will see that there is a small square. You just select that square and drag it down or drag it across the column or the row wherever you want to copy the formula, and automatically you will see that the same formula will be applied to all the cells in the worksheet. Wherever you want to put the same formula, you just simply drag the formula there, or if it is a discontinuous cell, then in that case you can simply do the copy and paste, and automatically the formula will be pasted in the other. So you can simply do this kind of a selection, and when you are done, finish with the pasting, you just press the escape and you use to deselect the selection. So once the selection has been pasted, once you've done with the work, you simply deselect it using the escape key. So here you can see the same thing has been shown here. You can see here in this corner, this is where you select and you just drag the column down. So if you have more data here and you want to calculate the total marks, then you just bring the mouse here and you drag it down until where you want to calculate this. So this will simply copy the same formula across the column. Also, one thing to notice that when the cells are copied, when the formula is copied to the second row, automatically the cell references will change. For example, here what you are seeing is the references of the third row, but here what you are seeing is the referencing of the fourth row. So here you see what you are seeing is C3 to E3, but here what you are seeing is C4 to E4, because when you copy the cell, automatically the referencing will change. You don't have to change that referencing. This kind of change in cell referencing is known as relative referencing. Cell reference is actually the word, is actually the term given to the address of a cell within the worksheet. So how do you call, how do you refer to a cell? You refer it by a cell reference. So A1, A2, E10, E6, all these are examples of cell references. So when you can simply copy the, you can simply drag and copy the formula and automatically these references get updated. So this type of method of referencing the cells, when the cell reference will change related to the position of the formula. When you copy the formula to the next cell, automatically the cell references will be updated. This kind of referencing is known as relative referencing because it depends on the location where the formula is pasted. When you copy the formula, automatically the referencing changes. This is known as relative referencing. Right. So, basically copied formulas or functions that have references are adjusted for the target cell or range of cells. So, basically when you copy and paste the formula, automatically the references will change just to adjust the formula or just to adjust the cells. So, sometimes it may be desirable, but there are situations when you don't want this to happen. You don't want that this kind of an automatic updation should take place. You want to restrict it that, you know, the value should be copied from a specific cell only. It should not be modified while you are copying. So, in that case, what you need is that you need a relative, you need a absolute reference. Absolute reference is a type of cell reference which will not change. Even when you paste the formula in another cell, that reference will remain constant. So, what you see here in this case is that, for example, when you have to calculate the percentage, so then here you see if you drag it down, you want this data to be read from this cell. But when you copy the formula down, so the formula automatically changes and it starts reading the value from this cell, because while dragging it automatically comes here. And when you do this way, it is going to give an error because this cell is a blank cell. So, therefore, when you divide this by this, it is going to show you an error. So, you can see here it is showing an error here, divide by 0, because this cell is an empty cell and while we are copying the formula, it tries to refer to this cell. So, this becomes an error. So, in this situation, this type of situation, what you need is that each time you copy the formula, this reference should remain constant. This should not change. So, for this, what you do is you do the different type of referencing that is known as relative reference. So, a relative reference is basically a cell reference that shifts when you copy it to a new location on a worksheet. So, basically it changes in relation to the change. So, when you copy the formula, automatically the reference will change. But what is an absolute reference is a cell reference that does not change when you copy the formula to a new location. So, to create an absolute reference, you preface the column and the row designations with a dollar sign. So, dollar sign means that instead of writing E6, you will write $E$6. So, by using this kind of a referencing, even when you copy or paste the formula in another cell, this reference will remain constant. The value from the cell which is fixed by an absolute reference will only be taken. So, here what you are seeing is $B$5, which is an absolute reference, and B5 is a relative reference. So, this $B$5 would stay the same no matter where you copied the formula. Even if you copy the formula, this reference would still remain the same. It will not change. So basically, this is the purpose of an absolute self-reference, that it automatically changes, it does not change automatically, and it remains fixed when the formula is copied. So this is a very important concept in Excel, because you need to understand how the cells can be referenced in specific situations. Now, another type of reference other than the absolute and the relative reference is known as the mixed reference. So basically, a mixed reference combines both the relative as well as the absolute references. So in this case, we can either fix the column by using the dollar sign and let the row change, or we can fix the row by using the dollar sign and let the column change. So if you write $B5, it means you are fixing the column. The B column will remain same, only the rows would shift. If you write $B5, it means that the row reference will not change, it will remain fixed, but the column reference will keep on changing. So the B will change to BCDE, but the 5 will remain the same. So this type of reference is known as mixed reference. So far we have discussed the different types of methods in which cells can be referred to, either relative or absolute or a mixed reference. Now, basically, we can switch between absolute, relative and mixed referencing in the formula easily in the edit mode or in the formula bar by selecting the cell reference in the formula and then pressing the F4 key repeatedly to toggle through the reference option. So, you don't have to bother about putting the dollar sign each time. You simply have to press F4 key and you will toggle between the different cell references, between absolute and relative and relative and absolute. Only by pressing the F4 key you can achieve this kind of a thing. Now, this is about the different ways in which cells can be referred. Another very important feature of Excel is the autofill feature. Now, autofill feature basically is that when you want to copy and paste a large number of rows or columns, you can use a technique called autofill. So basically, in this case, you may want to fill the same data in all the cells, or you may want to fill an incremental data like that for serial numbers, or you may want to fill some date, incremental dates or so on. So any kind of data that you want to fill in a large number of cells, the easiest method and the best method provided by the spreadsheet application is the autofill. So when you see here, when you want to fill any data here, so you see a small square, black square is there in the lower right corner of the selected cell or range. So you just have to select this and then you have to drag it. So basically, when you drag the fill handle, Excel automatically fills in the formula and the format used in the selected cell. Though the same rules for relative, absolute and mixed reference will apply, which are applied for mixed and relative reference will be applied for autofill also, like the same as for copy and pasting which you have been using. So basically, you can the fill behavior is very important to fill in dates, because you know sometimes dates are required. You need to fill up a large number of dates in a particular column. So for example, if you want to fill up incremental dates, so each days you want to put up like 1st March, 2nd March, 3rd March and so on, or you want to put two dates like 1st March, 1st April, 1st May like this. So basically, if you want to select two or more dates separated by a month, then Excel will increment the autofill dates by a month. So you can, what you have to do is that you fill in two or three dates in the cells and then you do the autofill. So Excel will automatically update that and incrementally months will be increment. If you only want to select the date, then Excel will increment date by one day only. So basically, this is a fill handle which you know, which provides this appearance to the cell, and the common options for using the fill handle are copy cells, fill series, fill formatting. When you right click there, you can see a large number of options are there in the fill dialog box, and depending on your requirement, you can choose whether you want to fill dates or serial numbers, etc., and carry on with it. Now we will be discussing about the different types of functions which are used in Excel. So, Excel's real power lies in the robust collection of functions. So, there are thousands of functions which are available for the user in Microsoft Excel particularly, and these functions, they are very easy and simple to use, which provides a large variety of functionality. So, we are going to discuss some important functions within each category as a part of this lecture, because discussing all the functions would be very redundant and may not be as a part of the scope of this lecture series. So, we are going to talk about the different categories in which the functions have been divided, so that the user can easily select and search for the specific function which he or she wants. So, we are basically going to talk about mathematical and trigonometrical functions, we are going to talk about statistical functions, logical functions, financial functions, functions related to date and time, then lookup functions, and we are also going to talk about some database functions and some other functions which are important and which may be used more popularly amongst the users. So, various types of functions are there. So, first and foremost, we are going to talk about the different mathematical functions which are available in Excel. So, the most common mathematical functions which are offered by Excel and which are used most commonly are, the first is the ABS function. So, ABS function basically stands for absolute value. So, this returns the absolute value of a number. Then the next function is the factorial function, to calculate the factorial of a number. So, this function is the fact function. Then if you want to calculate the logarithm of a number to a specified base, the function which is used is the log function. Then we have the power function, which returns the result of a number raised to a power, a specific power. Then we have the product function, which multiplies the arguments which you are specifying. Of course, we have talked about the sum function, which is a very basic function which adds the arguments, the values of the arguments. Then besides this, in Excel, in the mathematical functions category, we have the quotient function, which of course returns the integer portion of a division. Then we have the rand function, which returns a random number between 0 and 1. Then we have a rand between function, which returns a random number between the numbers that you specify. That is, you can specify a range, and between that range the number, random number, will be generated. Then we have very important and very most commonly used function, that is the round function, which rounds a number to a specified number of digits. Then we have a variant of the round function, which is the round down function, which rounds a number down towards 0. Then we have the round up function, which rounds a number up away from 0. Then of course, to find out the positive square root of a number, the function which you will use is the sqrt function. And then of course, you have the sum and the sum if function. The sum if function is a very important function, because in this you can give a criteria, and based on that criteria the cells will be summed. Then if you want to calculate the sum of squares of the arguments, the formula which you use is the sum sq function. This is more commonly used in case of statistical and trigonometrical calculations. And then you have the truncate function, the trunc function, which truncates a number into an integer. So, basically it truncates the number into an integer, it does not take about the sign of the number. Now, one of the very important and crucial functions which needs to be understood clearly is the use of rand function in Excel. Now, rand function, basically it returns an evenly distributed random number greater than or equal to 0 and less than 1. That is, it generates a random number between 0 and 1, and every time the sheet is calculated, a new number is generated. So, basically what we are saying is that if you want a set of data for any kind of experiment or any kind of statistical analysis, then you need a random sample. So, wherever you need a random sample, how do you get that? So for that you use a computer program to generate random numbers, and Excel is the simplest way in which you can generate random numbers, especially in case of wherever you have like computerized draw of lots or things like that. Then in those cases random numbers play a very important role. Now the problem here is that the rand function can be used to generate a random number, but then that random number keeps on changing. Every time the sheet is calculated, you perform any calculation on the sheet, you do any kind of interaction with the sheet, the number will change. So the point is that this number which is generated randomly between 0 and 1 may need to be changed, and it may also need it to be converted into a whole number. So for that it's simple. When you generate a random number using rand function, it will be in decimals. So you multiply that number by 100. So you get a number which is between 1 and 100. And then you can perform the round function on that, so that the number what you are getting is a whole number. Now the next step which is lying here, so for example this is the number which is generated using the rand function. So I simply type is equal to rand parenthesis, so I get a random number like this. Now if I want this number to be converted into a number, say for example 33, so what will I do? I can multiply this by 100. So, I get 33.765, so on, and then I can perform a round on that. So, then the number that I will get is either 33 or say 34. Now, I want to fix this number. So, when you want to fix this number, what you have to do is, fixing means that the number will be generated randomly, but whenever you are doing any change with the worksheet, it is not going to change the number. The number is not going to be recalculated, so the values will be fixed, because when you are carrying out a statistical experiment, you don't want that the data sample should keep changing. So you want a random data sample, but then you want it to be fixed. So I am showing you how this fixing of the random numbers can be done here. So these are, for instance, this is a number of random numbers which I have generated. For example, these are say 15-16 random numbers which have been generated simply by using the rand function and dragging the formula into these cells. Now what next you have to do is that you select this data and you right click and you choose copy. So basically you will copy this data. In the next step what you do is that you select the place where you want to have the fixed numbers and you say paste special, and in paste special you choose values. So basically what you are doing is you've just simply copied your data and you are pasting it at some other place wherever you want the fixed values to be, and you are not choosing paste but you are choosing paste special and values. So what will be pasted will be the computed value, and what you will see is that now these values which are pasted, these are not going to change. So these values are going to be fixed values. So it's simple, you just generate the random numbers. If you want 50 numbers, you generate them, just say copy, paste special and values at the place where you want the fixed data, and your data will be fixed, your random numbers will be fixed. So this way you can generate random numbers by using paste special and values, and the numbers which you will get is the fixed numbers. Then another function which is relevant to, which is similar to the rand, is the rand between function. Now in case of rand between function, it also generates a random number only, but you can specify a range in this case, rand between 10, 50. So in this case random numbers will be generated between 10 and 50 only. So that is another variant of the rand function which can easily be used, but there are certain spreadsheet applications which do not support the rand between function. So generally it is important to understand how a rand function works, and also the fixing of the random number will be the same. The steps to fix the random number will be the same whether you are using the rand or you are using the rand between. Now the next important function that we are going to use is the round function. So what you see here is that the syntax of the round function is round, and in parentheses you specify the number that you want to round off, comma, and then the number of digits after the decimal. So if the number is as specified here, and this is the number of digits that you want after the decimal place. So if the number is say 5.745 and you want one digit after the decimal, So then the number is rounded off like this. So here again the rule states that if it is 5 and above, then the number will be to the next hole. If it is less than 5, then the number will be towards the lesser hole. So it will be plus 1 or minus 1, the same way. Now if you want 2 decimal places, then this is the result that you get. If you put the number comma number of digits as 3, so you write the number here comma 3, this means you want 3 decimal places, the 3 digits after the decimal places. 0 means you don't want any digit after the decimal place, so the number will be rounded off to the next whole number. So no digits after the decimal place. But if you give minus 1, for example, if you give round number comma minus 1, then in that case it will be rounded off to the nearest 10. If you give minus 2, you can see here the number is rounded off to the nearest 100. If you give minus 3, the number is rounded off to the nearest 1000. So you can give the number of digits as positive, 0 or negative. So positive means 1 place, and negative 0 means no digits after the decimal, and negative means the rounding off will be taking place to the next 10, 100, 1000 and so on. So round function is round up, round down function also works similar to the round function. The only difference being round up will round to the next higher level, round down will round to the next lower level. Otherwise the rounding procedure and the results remain the same for these. Now the next important category of functions which we are going to discuss are the statistical functions. Now when we talk about the statistical functions, there are a number of important functions which are used. The first function which we have already discussed is the simplest function, known as the average. Now the average function, it returns the average. Average is the arithmetic mean, so it's the simple of whatever arguments you give. Average A is another variant of the average function, which returns the average of its arguments including numbers, text and logical values. So what is the difference between average and average A? Average function will only calculate the average of numeric data, that is only numbers. If there is any other type of data like text data or logical value or blank cell, average function is not going to consider that. But average A will calculate the average of all the numbers. Next function is the count function, which counts how many numbers are there in the list of arguments. So count will only count the cells where data exists. Count A will count the entire, how many values are in the list of arguments including blanks. So count A will include blanks also. Count will not include the blanks, and count blank will include only, will count the blank cells within the range. So if you want to know that out of cells A1 to A1000, how many values are blank, how many cells are blank, you use the count blank. If you want to use how many cells have value, you use the count. And if you want to use how many cells are there in all, you use the count A. So basically count A and count blank, these are three variants of the count function, which are, each of which is used for counting a different type of criteria, counting on a different type of criteria given the same range of data. Now important function in case of statistical analysis, a very important function, which is the frequency function. So Excel provides a very robust function for calculating the frequency of a data. So basically what is frequency? Frequency means how often the values occur within a range of values. So if you have 100 numbers and you want to find out 100 different, 100 integers, you want to find out how many times each occurs, that is known as the frequency. So basically this function, it returns a vertical array of numbers. As we have always seen, whenever we do frequency on a paper and pen, how do we do? We calculate, we have a range of cells, we have a range of data, we have say 50 different numbers, and then we calculate for each of these, we calculate a class interval, and then depending on the class interval, we calculate the frequency. Now here this frequency function will work on one entire column in one go. So therefore, this is known as an array of numbers. Array means a group of numbers. So in this case, we do not copy and paste the data. What we do is we compute it in such a way that in one single click, the value for all the class intervals frequency will be shown to us. So therefore, we use frequency to count the number of, say, test scores that fall within range of scores. So because frequency returns an array, therefore it must be entered as an array formula. So array formula is different from a regular formula, because in case of an array formula, it works on a range of cell in one go. At one instant, it works on multiple cells and it returns multiple values. When you get the result of the cell, it is not in one cell that you get, but you get it in multiple cells. So what is the syntax of the frequency function? The frequency function syntax is equal to frequency, then you write the data array, comma the bins array. So data array here means the group of cells or the references of cells which contain the data, and bins array here means the class interval. So you can take either the lower limit or you can take the upper limit, any particular limit you can take, any side of data you can take, either the lower limit or the upper limit. But the important thing to note here is that this formula will be entered as an array formula, not a regular formula. So basically, if this is your data, so you can see here how it has been used. You have put the frequency function, you write is equal to frequency, data array and bins array. Now, how you go about entering this formula is, so for example, this is your class interval and this column you want to calculate the frequency. So what you have to do is that with the mouse, you select this entire column. The entire column has to be selected with the mouse. Then without touching the mouse, you will see that the first cell remains white and the rest of the cells, they appear blue. When you will select this column, you will see first cell will remain white, the color will not change, rest of the cells will remain blue. Just in this place, you start typing the frequency formula in the first cell, which is white. You don't touch the keyboard, you don't touch the mouse, you just simply start typing, and you type is equal to frequency, you put the parenthesis, you put the reference for the data array, comma, you put the reference for the bins array, you close the parenthesis. And now instead of pressing the enter key, for the regular formula what we do is we just press the enter key, but here what you will press is control shift and enter. In case of Mac operating system, you will press command shift and enter. So the moment you will press control shift and enter or command shift and enter, you will see automatically in one go data will be filled in the entire column. And you will see that curly braces are inserted in the formula automatically. So this means that Excel has converted your formula into a array formula. Once again, I will repeat, you just select this cell, first cell remains white, the other cells becomes blue, then you start typing the formula in the first cell. You type the frequency formula is equal to frequency, data array, comma bins array, and then you press control shift and enter. Automatically you will see that data will be filled in all these cells in one go, and parentheses or curly braces are inserted in case of your formula. You will see curly braces are inserted. So you can see that the frequency formula which we are using is an array formula. There are some other array formulas also which are used in case of Excel and advanced Excel, which we shall be discussing later on. But for the moment, this is one simple example of how an array function works. Now next are date and time functions. So there are a number of functions which you can use for calculation of date and time. For example, if you want to insert today's date, so the function is today, and there are a number of functions as you can see here for calculation, different calculations related to date and time. So basically Excel stores the dates in the form of integers. So where the integer value represents the number of days since January 1st 1900. So for example, each date has its equivalent integer value. For example, 1st January 2008 is known, is represented as 39448, because it is 39,448 days after January 1st 1900. So basically Excel will automatically format these them into appear into date format. So for each date it has an equivalent integer. So you can do it either way. If you get the date, you can convert it into integer. If you have an integer, you can convert it into date. And because it is considered as an integer, therefore plus minus or calculation on dates becomes easy. So for example, if you want 7 days ahead of 1st January 2008, so it will not do the calculation on 1st January, but it will do the calculation on 39448 plus 7. So then it will automatically convert the result into date and it will return it to you. Therefore, Excel has a real power in calculations of various dates and different formats of the date and time functions. So it allows, because of this only, it becomes very easy to work with dates just the way we work with numbers. So we use common functions like date, which will return the date, day will return the day of the week, month will return the month. Now will return today's day and time, today will return today's date, weekday will return what is the day of the week, and year of course will return the current year of the date of the system date. So today and now functions, they are very important because they are generally used in they are generally inserted in the Excel sheets. So they always display the current date and time. So basically, normally the time portion is not seen unless the cell has been formatted to display it, because the width of the cell is less and therefore the time portion is omitted. But if you change, if you configure the cell accordingly, then you can of course see the time option also up to milliseconds. So if you see today or now function in a cell, the date in the cell is updated to reflect the current date, and the time of your computer each time you open the workbook will be seen. So therefore, this is an interesting function for the beginners because it will keep showing the updated date and time in the Excel sheet. Whenever you will open the worksheet, it will show the current date and current time to you. So basically, this is a simple example of showing how the date function has been used in case of a worksheet. Now, next we are going to talk about financial functions. Now, we understand that financial functions are very useful in calculating information about loans. There is a wide variety of other financial functions also, which are of great importance in calculations, and therefore Excel is used in large number of financial institutions and organizations for calculations of preparation of balance sheet, different types of accounts, reports, etc. Now here we are going to talk about some very commonly used financial functions like the future value function, the IPMT function, the PMT, the PPMT, and the present value or the PV function. So all these financial functions, they have similar arguments and they differ only based upon which function you are using. So the arguments will remain the same, but some functions use a specific arguments, some functions will not use a specific argument. So these functions are specially relevant because they are used in calculation of installments of loans, in calculation of future value of assets, or in calculation of present value of a future asset, or in calculation of interest paid, and in calculation of total payment which is made in lieu of a particular loan. So basically we use the financial functions. So first function is the FV function. FV stands for future value of an investment based on periodic constant payments and a constant interest rate per period. The IPMT function provides the interest payment or portion of the overall periodic loan payment. So I stands for interest and PMT stands for payment. So basically IPMT is used to find out the interest which is being paid when you are paying the installment for a specific loan. PMT function calculates the entire periodic payment of the loan, that is total payment, how much it was, and the PPMT function just calculates the principal payment, that is, out of the total payment, how much was the interest can be calculated by the IPMT, and what was the principal paid can be calculated by the PPMT function of the overall periodic payment. Then we have the PV function, which calculates the present value of an investment, of a future investment. If you want to calculate the present value, then you use the present value or the PV function. So, here is a short description of the different types of financial functions which are used and their arguments or the various parameters which these functions will take. So, you can see here in case of PMT function, the first is the rate. So, rate here stands for the rate of interest. Then we have the number of periodicities or the number of periods, the number of payment periods, and then we have the present value. So, number of payment period means that if you take a loan for 4 years and you pay monthly installment, so the number of payment periods will be 48. And then you, of course, you have the present value, which is the principal amount of the loan. So, we shall be continuing with the financial functions in the following lectures. Till then, thank you.